She was a part of the 1997-98 undefeated season at Tennessee, the Lady Vols under Pat Summitt, also an All-American. She went on for a 15-year career, WNBA national champs in 2012, MVP, and just recently this past summer won her fourth gold medal world champion in basketball. Tamika Catchings Smith, would you come?
Well, I remember, I'm gonna use the ball. I don't need that. I sat at the free throw line. I shot the ball. The ball came back to me, and I shot at the free throw line. And I shot the ball. And my coach said, I want you to do it again. But this time, I want you to close your eyes. So I sat at the free throw line. And I airballed it. My coach said, have a little faith. Have a little faith. And so I got back up there. You know my routine by now, right? Closed my eyes. And I made it. Every time I come out and speak, and this being my second time, I always like to have a theme. And today's theme is have a little faith. And it ties into basketball for me because when I shot the ball with my eyes open, I could see what I was shooting for. I could see it. But when I closed my eyes, what happened? You have to rely on your faith, and you have to rely on knowing if I do the same thing, one, two, three. It will go in. Have a little faith. And so when I talk, I always use acronym. So today we're gonna use FAITH. Everybody know how to spell FAITH? Let's say it together. F-A-I-T-H. Very good. I was a little worried because when we were doing worship, we were over here clapping and all you guys were like. So Matthew 17:20, because you have so little faith, truly I tell you, if you have faith as small as a mustard seed, you can say to this mountain, move from here to there, and it will move. Nothing will be impossible. And I add this, just believe. So faith, the F. Focus on his vision. When I came last time, and I know we might have some new people, so I'll refresh you guys too. But when I came last time, focus on his vision. I was born with a hearing problem, a speech problem. I had to wear hearing aids, and literally I got made fun of for the majority of my middle school years, or elementary years. And I remember every single day walking to and from school and getting made fun of. And last time I talked about all I wanted was to just fit in. I wanted to be quote unquote normal, or whatever that is. But I just wanted to have one day where I could fit in and I could blend in with everybody else. Well, one day, when I was in second grade. Every day that year, I had walked to and from school with my brother and my sister, and every day I had gotten made fun of. And I remember this one day, I woke up and I said, today is gonna be different. Today is gonna be a good day. And I went to school, and right off the bat, I got made fun of for the way that I talk. I got made fun of for the hearing aids that I had to wear. And I got made fun of for being different. But today was supposed to be a good day. How can it not be a good day? And so I started crying, went through the rest of the day, got made fun of some more. And I remember walking home from school, and I was behind my brother and my sister, and I'm crying. But they were so used to me crying, they're like, okay, that's just her. But as we were walking, I took those hearing aids out of my ears, and I put them in my hand, and I threw them as far as I could. Because today was gonna be. Because today was gonna be a good day. And so I walked home, and once we got home, my mom always had a routine. We would have our snack, we would do our homework, and then we would go do whatever sport we were in. It happened to be softball. So we went, I had my snack, did my homework, and we went to softball practice. And if you remember the story last time, I was one of those, I'm a tomboy, so I love to get dirty. Yes. So I played catcher, and then they put me in left field, but I didn't want to be confined to one space. So I played left field, center field, and right field, all at the same time. So after practice that day, my mom was looking at me, and she said, you know what? There's something different about you. I don't know. And you know those looks that your mom gives you. Where are your hearing aids at, young lady? I don't know. And so we went back, and we went to left field, and we went to center field, and we went to right field. And then we went to every base, first base, second base, third base. We lifted them up. We went to home plate. Lifted up home plate. Looked all around. Guess what? We did not find those hearing aids. So then I think we all pack into the car and I think we're going home. Well, no, we're not going home. We get home and we walk to the school, and then we walk from the school, back and forth, looking for those hearing aids. Well, we never found the hearing aids. And when we got back home, my mom sat me down and she said, Tamika, your father and I cannot afford to keep buying you hearing aids every time you lose them. So you're gonna have to figure out how to live without your hearing aid. And I looked at my mom with a sad face. And then when I turned around, but I learned right then and there that there was gonna be something that I was gonna have to do to get by in school. So I learned really fast how to read lips. So I always joke around with the kids. I can tell, I know what you're saying. If you're talking about me, I can read your lips. But I did three things. I would always sit in the front row. I would always read chapters. I would read chapters before I went to school. Because I figured something that I read, my teacher would have to talk about. And then the third thing, I would always stay after class and talk to my teachers. I know, it's weird, but you have to talk to your teachers. But for me, as long as I could see my teacher's mouth, I could understand. So I'd have words and then blank and words and blank. Because every single time they turned around to write on the chalkboard, what happened? I couldn't see their lips. And so that I would have to stay after class. So we're talking about focusing on a vision, focusing on his vision. It started, excuse me, I don't need water, though. It started from that little girl. And my first goal was just to be normal. And then the second goal came in seventh grade. And that goal was to be in the NBA. And then the third goal came my freshman year in college. And that goal was to be in the WNBA. And then life has just continued to roll out. We all have something, some vision, some goal, something that you know God had put you out to do. And that leads me to my A, because faith, F-A, exactly what she said. Ask. Ask. Ask for direction. One of my favorite songs is Ask by Anthony Evans. And part of the word goes, everyone who asks receives, and everyone who seeks will find. And everyone who knocks, the door will be open to you. The first time I listened to that song, I was like, wow, something so simple, but yet so hard for all of us. Ask, and the door will be open. Seek, and you will find. Knock, and the door will be open. For me, it started with basketball. Third grade was the first time that I picked up a basketball. My father played in the NBA for 11 years. He played for Milwaukee Bucks, New Jersey Nets, Philadelphia 76ers, and the Los Angeles Clippers. I know, I always joke around with him. I'm like, yeah, sometimes I forget all your teams, but I hope you never forget what team I play. It's an inside joke, but I just remember the first time picking up that basketball. And then I remember in seventh grade when I made the goal to be in the NBA. And then you fast forward and you go to freshman year when the WNBA came. For me, especially when I was younger, I would go to church. I would come and my mom and dad, if we didn't go to church on Sunday, we couldn't do anything for the rest of the week. So you know what? We were in church. Passing out, eating candy, all the stuff we shouldn't have been doing when we were kids. But that seed was planted. And as I got older, especially got into my freshman year, we went undefeated. Pastor talked about it. We went undefeated that year. And I remember at the end of the year, you know, everything, to throw the ball up, and we're all so excited. And I was like, man, if this is how college is going to be, whoa, I am in for the ride of my life. Well, then sophomore year came, and we lost a couple games. And you would have thought the world was over. People crying, angry, arguments, all of that. Something's missing. And I was riding down the road one day, and there was a big billboard on the side of the road. Revival. Some church revival, and I don't know what it was, but it caught my eye. Revival. So I remember going back, and I went back to the dorm, and I told, we came in at the Fab Four, and I told my teammates, I said, look, I saw this billboard. It's almost like it was speaking to me. I don't know how many times do you go up and down a road, and then one day you look up, and you're like, gosh, has that always been there? Where did that come from? Oh, that's always been there. But I said, we gotta go. And we went to the church. And the four of us, we all had different relationships with our father. My mom and dad are divorced. One of them, their father, hadn't seen their father, had never seen their father. The second one, her father was always around. He was the team dad. And the fourth one hadn't seen her dad since third grade. We're freshmen or sophomores in college. And so as we went in and we sat down, the preacher talked about, who's your daddy? Who your daddy? And he talked about the importance of not only focusing on your earthly, or not always focusing on your earthly father, but more importantly, focusing on him. And for me, up to that point, I thought I thought I could do everything. And I had been in church, right? We're all in church, and we grow up, and, you know, that seed had been planted. But I thought I was the reason that I was so successful. I was the reason that I had made it this far. Basketball was my God. Until that day, being back in church. And at the end of the service, just like any service, the pastor stood up here and asked if there's anybody here that wants to rededicate their life, if there's anybody here that wants to go come back to the Lord, if there's anybody here that wants something different, that there's something missing in your life, I'm asking you, come to the front. And with tears streaming down all of our faces, all four of us walked to the front and rededicated our life to Christ. When you ask for direction and you seek what he's trying to show us, what do you think happens? Faith. So you focus on his vision. You ask for direction, and then you ignite those around you. Every day, and my friends know this, every single day, when they see me, the first thing I say is, good morning, sunshine! And I get the same response. But no matter if I'm here, no matter if I'm on the phone, no matter where I am, it's always the same. Because how many of you, and you can raise your hand, how many of you like being around people that just bring you down? Just bring you down. How many of you like being around people like that? Raise your hand. Come on, raise your hand. Okay, we got a hand back there. She's two, but it's okay. None of us do. When you're filled with the Holy Spirit and you're filled with that faith and you have that energy, you ignite the people around you. It's the energy that you have. 3 years ago, we got a rookie on our team. I'm not going to say her name right now. I might later. We had a rookie on our team. Every single day, you get up, and every single day that I get up, I'm always the same person every day. No matter what's going on, for the most part, I'm always the same person. When I drive up to the arena, I'll have 50 million things going on in my head. But when I step out of the car and I walk to the locker room, those 50 million things get placed on hold so that I can focus on my teammate. So every morning, when you come in the locker room, I'm always the first one there. I was always the first one there. What would you hear? That wasn't very good. That's not a good morning for me. What would you hear?
Good morning.
Good morning, sunshine. Well, I had this one teammate that was not a morning person when she came in. Well, she ended up having a locker right next to mine. So I broke her out of that real quick. But one of the things, when you talk about igniting, and you talk about just being able to make an impact, I think about Pat. I think about Pat Summit. And everybody always asks, like, who are the people in your life that have showed you, that have given you direction? Well, of course, God. But then he uses people in our lives. And Pat was that influence for me. Because every single day, she came and gave 150%, if that's even possible, in every single thing that she did. And I told this story last time I was here about my first day of practice. Up until that first day, I never had really been told by my coach that I hadn't done anything wrong. So like most high school seniors that graduate and go to college, that think they're perfect, I was one of them. And that first practice, I learned real fast that I wasn't as good as I thought I was. Pat wanted me to play defense, and I wanted to play defense the way I know how to play defense. And so I got up. Do we have any defensive players in here? Who loves defense and basketball? Who loves, I know you do. Who else? You love defense? Anybody else? Who loves offense? Now everybody's hand goes, I love to shoot. Well, I love to shoot. I have an older sister. She was the defensive player, and I was the offensive player. I shot, she passed, and played defense. So that first day of practice, I remember getting up, and I got up there to play defense. And Pat said, Tamika, get your butt down and get your arms out. Butt down, arms out. Boom. Well, I got beat. And I got beat again. And I got beat again. And finally, I made a stop. And I went to the end of the line. And I remember, she doesn't know what she's talking about. Got me playing defense like that. You see, I got beat 3 times. In my head, I said that. When I got back to the front, Tamika, get your butt down and get your arms out. Butt down, arms out. And guess what? I got beat. Again and again and again. This cannot be the way to play defense. So now I'm mad, right? I'm mad. And I go to the end of the line. And the next time, as I'm getting to the front, I look over. And so if we're on that side of the court, we're on this side of the court going to that basket, and I get in the front, and now Pat is beyond that wall, back to the court, talking to people, because we always had open practice. So first day, we came in, like I said, at the 5-4, so the stands were packed with people that had come to see what is the hype about these four freshmen. So she's way back there talking to somebody, and I get up, and all of a sudden, Tamika! And I said, what? And everybody went quiet. And then for me, I was like, did I say that? Or did I think I said that? And as I looked around, I realized, oh my gosh. I said, what? And she started walking from the corner, get your butt down and get your arms out. Butt down, arms out. And again, I got beat over and over and over, and finally went to the end of the line. Well, I thought I was going to the end of the line. Well, she calls me underneath the basket, and in the gym that we have, there's always a little thing, and she had, I can't do it because I have a dress on, okay? But she had her leg up and her arm. Do I have to send you back to Duncanville, Texas? I said, no, because if you don't kill me, my mama's going to kill me. And I'd rather you kill me. And she went through a whole spill. And we finally left. She finally was like, okay, get back in the end of the line. And I remember that whole practice. This is my first practice. My first freshman year. My heart was pounding for the whole practice. And after practice, I went back, I took my shower and went upstairs and I said, look, Pat, I'm sorry. Please don't tell my mom. But I went and I apologized. But when you talk about somebody igniting you and somebody wanting the best for you in every single situation, because it wasn't like I was terrible at defense. I just wasn't up to her standard in defense. And it's cool because a few years ago, we got an opportunity to go hear John Maxwell speak. He spoke down at Banker's Life. And he talked about being mediocre and how people nowadays are so content with being mediocre. So you have a job to do, and you just do your job. And in this instance, you play defense, and you're okay. You're an okay defensive player, but you score 50, and the person you're guarding scores 50. Yeah, being mediocre. But when I started kind of thinking about igniting somebody, I started thinking about him and how every single day he challenges us, whether we know it or not. I give you a little, and what do you do with the little? Based on what you do with the little will depend on how much more I can give you. If you do what you're supposed to do, and you give 120%, then when you have to do something over here, because you've put so much hard work into this, you're able to do something else. As a leader, one thing you learn really fast, and you guys can attest to this, one thing you learn really fast is that people are always watching you. So whatever you do, and however you do it, the person that's watching you can do it just like that. Trust the process. Trust the process. That's pretty self-explanatory. Through my life and through every single thing that I've done, thank God, I've been able to trust the process. Trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not on your own understanding. Proverbs 3:5. Every step of the way, and I'm gonna read this because I wrote this down, but every step of the way leads you to the next step in his journey for us. I look at my life and the pieces of my journey. Growing up, I had a hearing impairment. That was adversity. Dealing with adversity. Throwing my hearing aids out, adaptability. Gotta flip it into positive, okay? Positive. Freshman year, my preparation for my future. Pat Summit. I threw my hearing aids out in second grade. Literally went from second grade all the way to my freshman year in college, not high school, in college, without my hearing aids. Freshman year. And after practice one day, Pat said, hey, you know what? I want to talk to you. And I said, what? You want to talk to me? She said, yeah, I want to, you know, Jenny Moshak, who's our trainer, we want to talk to you. And in my mind, right off the bat, because I'm thinking back to my first practice, I was like, what did I do wrong? She said, no, I just want to talk to you. And so I went into the training room, and I'm sitting there, and she says, you know, when people can't see very well, what do they need? I'm like, oh, glasses. I wear glasses. I wear contacts, you know, glasses. And then she went through a series of things. Sometimes when people walk with a limp, sometimes what do they need? I'm like, oh, they need something in their shoe. And the last thing was when people can't hear. Got me. When people can't hear, what do they need? Hearing aids. From second grade to freshman year in college, people need hearing aids. And then she went on this whole spill about, you know what, Catch? That's my nickname. One day, you will be able to impact thousands of people through your story, through your testimony. You will be able to reach, touch, and talk to thousands of people. And I remember looking at her like you guys are looking at me, whatever. Yeah. Because I didn't believe it. That goes back to the vision. Some people see in us what we don't even see in ourselves. Because up until that point, I didn't really talk to people at all. I would talk to my teammates, I would talk to the people, some of the people that I had to talk to through class. But other than that, I didn't really talk. But that right there, preparation for the future. And from that, we did a big announcement about my hearing disability. And the email, and the letters, and the phone call that Tennessee got regarding me, off the chain. Started getting parents, started getting teachers, started getting all types of people that called. My daughter's hearing impaired. My son's hearing impaired. I have a student that's crazy. But she prepared that. And she set the stage for that. A weakness got turned into a strength. And then from there, rookie season, when I first got to Indiana, I tore my ACL. So I didn't get to play the first year. And I remember our community relations director, she came up to me and she said, hey, Catch, I want you to go on the speaking circuit. I said, yeah, no, I don't talk in front of people. No, that's just not for me. She said, no. We'll write out a speech for you. Literally, we'll write it verbatim, everything on one paper. All you have to do is read it. So, okay, I can read. So I had an auditorium full of kids, and we go on this speaking circuit. Now, I told you, I didn't want to do it. But then when we wrote down the speech and I did it the first time, I literally stood here and read verbatim, word for word, and then put it down and walked away. And then the second time I did it, I didn't have to use the words as much, and then the third time, not as much, and the fourth time, until finally it got to the point where I didn't really need the paper. And we talked about the fever. For every victory earns respect. For every victory earns respect. Even now I remember it because I did it so many times. But you talk about setting the stage and every single thing, trusting the process. So in every single thing that we do and every single thing that we do in our lives, how it continues to set you up for the next stage. Trust in the process. Your journey, my journey, is our testimony. Is your testimony. When we try to take the wheel, which we all do at some point in time, instead of trust in the process, it never works. Which leads me to the H. Hold on and enjoy the ride. I've been blessed. I mean, even watching the video, it hasn't been that long ago, but watching it is kind of like, man, the journey that I've been on. And even through the ups and downs and the things that you're able to learn and the things that you are able to accomplish, it's been fun. It's been fun. All of us, we all have our own story. We all have our own journey. We all have our own ups and downs. We all have our own challenges. But it's all what we make of it. It's all what we do with it. But I know for me, and through the journey that I've been on, as a little girl in second grade, with everything that I dealt with, I never could have dreamed nor imagined everything that's gone on. Representing your country 4 times, playing on a championship team on every level, being able to be up here and talk about my faith and talk about the things that are important to me. The process and the journey has been fun. And so for each one of us in this room, and me included, as we kind of move on, it's all about faith. It goes back to that little mustard seed. So my pastor sometimes brought a mustard seed, and I'm sure your pastor has too, and put it on his hand, and you can't even see it. Because that's how small it is. But when you trust the process, when you ask for direction, when you follow the vision that he's given you, and when you have positive influences in your life, and or you are one of them, the journey that you're on, it becomes a part of you. It is you. Miracles happen to people who want, need, or reach for them. I'm going to say that again. Miracles happen to people who want, need, or reach for them. But even in miracles, you have to have faith. So on the count of three, everybody's going to jump up on their feet. All right, and then I'll tell you what to do from there. 1, 2, 3. Okay, yeah, too slow. Sit down. We're gonna try this again. 1, 2, 3. All right, okay. And on the count of three, we're gonna say, have a little faith. And we're going to finish that with just believe. But this is my challenge now. You got to say it really loud. All right? And if you want to add like an extra jump, I can't do it in my dress, you can do that too, okay? Have a little faith, just believe. Ready? 1, 2, 3.
Have a little faith, just believe.
All right. God bless y'all.
Thank you so much for being here. What a challenge. I'm going to ask the praise team to come up and let's go to the Lord in prayer before we have our invitation. Father, I thank you for Tamika and for her testimony and for the road that you've taken her on her journey throughout her life. And I thank you for the great amount of that road that still lays ahead of her. I know she said she'll be in 5 or 6 states in 5 or 6 days coming up. And we ask that you go with her and that you bless her. I thank you for her interest and her love for children and her commitment to seeing that they get some of the same breaks that she got as she was growing up. I thank you for her vulnerability in talking about overcoming the things that were obstacles to her. And I thank you for your faithfulness in her life and for bringing her through those. Thanks for bringing her to Indiana. Thanks for letting her be a a pride of Hoosier basketball for 15 years now. And I just am excited about what you have for in the future. And thank you for the challenge that she's laid before us to rise above being average and mediocre, to seeing what you want us to be, and then tapping into that power source through the Holy Spirit in each one of us. That's our prayer as we end this morning, that we would live up to not our expectations, but yours, and that we would never settle for less. We love you, and it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.